describe and show how COPD feels is if you try to breathe through a wee straw repeatedly. That is awfully difficult to do. COPD constricts the flow of oxygen into the lungs and the circulation, and it causes breathlessness, tiredness, coughing, and often poor mental health, depression, obviously, and it can lead to a person feeling lonely and isolated. At every stage and at every age, there is an opportunity to prevent and treat COPD. Improvements in treatment is vital, as there are 300 million cases of COPD across the world, and the disease is the third biggest cause of death globally. Exposure to tobacco smoke and other inhaled toxic particles and gases are the main COPD risk factors. Treatments for COPD include inhalers, tablets, and for a small number of people, surgery or a lung transplant. Pulmonary rehabilitation is also effective and can prevent a COPD exacerbation, which typically leads to a 4 to 8 day hospital stay, which can cost the Scottish NHS an estimated £3,000 per person per hospital stay. Presiding officer, a recent survey by Asthma UK and the British Lung Foundation in Scotland, they have a report that's called Failing in the Fundamentals. It surveyed 8,000 people from across all four nations in the UK who have a diagnosis of COPD, and this report was just published. The survey asked those living with COPD whether they felt they were receiving the five principles of COPD care, which are being offered smoking cessation, offered pneumococcal and flu vaccine, offered pulmonary rehabilitation, offered a personalised self-management plan, and optimising treatment for comorbidities. The majority of respondents to the survey conveyed that they were not receiving these five fundamentals of COPD care. However, out of the respondents, 652, 8.1% of the total, were resident in Scotland. So that might seem a bit of a low number for the Scottish respondents, so it might be an interesting opportunity for the Scottish Government to pursue a wider survey of, or a wider audit of, Scottish residents with COPD. But the survey has highlighted that improvements in the prevention and care of COPD are required, especially as many people with poor lung health shielded during the first lockdown, and winter is fast approaching, where those with COPD are at a higher risk of infection. In Scotland, there is a wide range of action which is being taken, to better support those living with COPD. The Respiratory Care Action Plan for Scotland, led by Dr Tom Farden from the NHS Tayside, it sets out the Scottish Government's vision for driving improvement in the prevention, diagnosis, care, treatment and support of people living with respiratory conditions. An implementation programme was initiated in summer 2021 to roll out the commitments outlined in the plan in partnership with the respiratory community. The conditions in this plan: asthma, COPD, idiopathic pulmonary fibrosis, bronchiectasis and obstructive sleep apnea syndrome make up the majority of workload of respiratory physicians in Scotland. Although each condition presents its own challenges, there are common problems. The plan therefore encourages new and innovative approaches and intends to share best practice to promote a whole system approach to respiratory care. It is welcome work, and I look forward to continuing to see it progress. Dumfries and Galloway in my South Scotland region has a higher prevalence of COPD than in any other parts of Scotland. And across Dumfries and Galloway, 4,600 people are living with COPD. That's 3 in every 100 people, compared with the Scottish average of 1.8 in every 100. Stranraer is also an unexplained hotspot for COPD. And researchers from the BREATH project, which is Border Regions Airways Training Hub, which was funded by 7.7 million of euros for Interreg funding, they're examining factors for this, including air quality, levels of ozone, genetic links, social deprivation, and the agriculture and industry in the area. Prior to this debate, I received an update from Professor John Lockhart on the work of the BREATH project, and I'm pleased that BREATH have recommenced school visits, the most recent to Girvan Academy. And recently, the BREATH project has awarded a BREATH Challenge Certificate to Moffat Academy and Belmont Primary School in Stranraer. This award is provided for young people for education received on the importance of maintaining good respiratory health. I'm joining the team to Douglas Ewart High School visit in Newton Stewart in the new year. And I want to thank Dr. John Lockhart and the team for their research. Presiding Officer, there have been calls to have a COPD Centre of Excellence created in Stranraer. And while I understand the reasons for this, it would need to be a cooperation and collaboration with NHS D&G, with the leadership, the clinicians and the multidisciplinary team. And wider consideration would need to include other conditions which also require the respiratory team input and perhaps a Scotland-wide digital centre for lung health excellence or perhaps a lung health hub. That would mean that the learning and engagement with and from the wider Scottish NHS experts would be able to take place. Finally, Presiding Officer, in raising awareness of World COPD Day, I briefly want to highlight that COPD is often a hidden disability. Yesterday at the Lung Health Cross Party Group, we heard from Julie MacLeod of Breathe Easy Clackmannanshire. Julie has COPD and is quite breathless sometimes. She was told by someone that she didn't look disabled. COPD is quite disabling for many people who are diagnosed. Much work is already underway, and I again welcome the work of the Respiratory Care Action Plan team, and I look forward to seeing the progress. I look forward to hearing contributions of other members ahead of tomorrow's World COPD Day, and thank Presiding Officer for allowing me to speak this evening.
Thank you. Thank you very much indeed, Ms Harper. We now move to the debate. Firstly, Alexander Stewart, who will be followed by Carol Mochan. Around 4 minutes, Mr Stewart.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. Can I congratulate my fellow co-convener for the cross-party group on lung health, Emma Harper, on securing this debate this evening? World COPD is organised by the Global Initiative on Chronic Obstructive Lung Disease. This is a collaboration of healthcare professionals and COPD patient groups throughout the world, and their aim is to raise awareness, share knowledge, and discuss ways to reduce the burden on individuals who have the condition. This year's theme is Healthy Lungs, Never More Important. And that theme, Deputy Presiding Officer, is very poignant. Its aim is to ensure that COPD is organised and that individuals across the world can be supported. Notwithstanding the threat of COVID, COPD remains a leading cause of death worldwide. It needs to be, and we need to be reminded about the focus on lung health. To end this, we need to ensure that there is support. Avoiding extensive air pollution and occupational processes is simply crucial. It's also there to ensure that regular physical activity is required, and whatever level possible is essential. As we have heard already, COPD contains a group of conditions. They include bronchitis, emphysema, that will make a real difference. And we've already heard that it's like emptying the air through lungs and extreme airways will continue to narrow. The condition is unfortunately progressive and long term. And with acute care, we know that about 141,000 people across Scotland have the disease. However, the figure could be even worse, Deputy Presiding Officer, because we believe that two-thirds of people with COPD do not know they have it because they're undiagnosed. Last year, I was honoured to have been nominated as the British Lung Foundation Smoking Cessation Champion for this Parliament, and I am equally honoured that the role has also been reinstated for me during this session. While we widely accept, and it's not all the case, but there is a connection between smoking and COPD, and we need to ensure the damage. Therefore, it's vitally important that we ensure that campaigns happen across the country to indicate to young people the dangers of smoking. In my role as co-convener of the cross-party group, I'm very privileged to meet many individuals, Deputy Presiding Officer, who come to that group and give us a real inspiration. And there's no more so than Linda MacLeod, BME. She is, along with like-minded individuals across my area, and looks after and supports Breathe Easy Clackmannanshire, which is an area within my own region. The organisation itself recently received the Queen's Award for volunteering. That shows the highest esteem that they can receive. And to this end, I spoke with Linda about what was happening with reference to Forth Valley, the area within our own region. And there are real issues about what is happening in the wee county. We know that individuals who require support can have that, but they need the pulmonary rehabilitation service across the county to ensure that Tragically, shortly after we had that discussion, the pulmonary rehab unit was relocated to Larbert. And then we had the issue where it was delivered on a video conferencing pulmonary rehabilitation service. But, presiding officer, that has now been removed altogether. So the situation we now have across the Wee County is that without that pulmonary rehab service, it is affecting many individuals. They now have to travel a considerable distance, many on buses, number of buses, and that for some of them is virtually impossible. Estimates suggest over 3,000 people in Forth Valley could benefit from pulmonary rehabilitation. And I hope that the Minister will consider that in her summing up, because we know that the average cost for pulmonary rehab is about £130 per patient. But a patient in hospital, it raises to £3,000. So these are vitally important. So in conclusion, Deputy Presiding Officer, 6% of all deaths in Scotland are attributed to lung disease, ensuring access. So therefore, pulmonary care is vitally important. It's crucial that that pulmonary rehabilitation service is maintained and retained locally, because by doing that, it ensures that more people with COPD can access the healthcare they require. Thank you.
Thank you very much indeed, Mr Stewart. I now call on Carol Mockin, who will be followed by Rona Mackay. 4 minutes, Ms Mockin.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. And can I thank Emma Harper, as she often does with so many conditions, for bringing this important debate to the Chamber. On behalf of Scottish Labour, I would like to welcome World COPD Day that takes place tomorrow and recognise this year's theme, as we've heard, of healthy lungs, never more important. The prevalence of COPD in Scotland and indeed globally should cause all of us concern. And as Emma Harper mentions in her motion and in her words, the increasing prevalence of COPD means that it is estimated to be the third most frequent cause of mortality worldwide by 2030. However, in order to stop this worrying trend, I consider it important that the causes are understood and highlighted. It is well known that smoking is the most common cause of COPD, being the leading factor for 9 out of 10 cases, according to NHS Scotland. This means that around 90% of COPD cases can be tracked back to a single cause, which highlights for this Parliament where action must be taken to address the trends we are currently seeing. The Scottish Government in 2018 set out plans to create a smoke-free generation by 2034, protecting those born from 2013 from the adverse impacts of smoking. And I and Scottish Labour support this move. And I hope in the longer term it will address what will be an even more challenging condition in Scotland. However, Deputy Presiding Officer, we need more action now to protect those living with COPD. This condition is another that disproportionately impacts the poorest in our society and, sadly, is another example of where the Scottish Government are falling short when it comes to addressing health inequalities. The Scottish Burden of Disease Study Deprivation Report in 2016 highlighted that COPD was one of the leading causes of ill health or early death in Scotland's poorest communities. Indeed, in 2019, Ash Scotland reported that more than five times the number of people in the most deprived groups smoke compared to the least deprived. Deputy Presiding Officer, this highlights for us a clear link again in Scotland, where poorer people in Scotland's most deprived areas are more likely to suffer from health conditions such as COPD, and as such are more likely to have their quality of life reduced further. However, the inequalities are not limited to smoking. The Health and Safety Executive suggests that also linked to increased chances of getting COPD is working in construction, in textiles, in factories and in welding. In each of these places, there are low-paid workers, often from more deprived areas. If already smokers, could be at further risk of facing significant health difficulties in the form of COPD. Deputy Presiding Officer, Chest, Heart and Stroke Scotland report that people living with long-term health conditions like COPD are at greater risk of admission to hospital if they are not supported to manage their conditions and have a high level of loneliness, isolation and poor mental health. Therefore, it is right that Emma Harper highlights the need for greater focus on COPD care, and I believe such focus should include taking the advice of organisations such as Chest, Heart and Stroke Scotland, considering programmes such as their Hostel to Home support services, which offers direct post-diagnosis support. COPD is another condition that highlights and exacerbates the already significant health inequalities Scotland face. I welcome that the motion tonight makes reference to health inequalities underpinned by smoking, air pollution and poor quality housing, but we cannot accept that ability to debate health inequalities in this Parliament should be limited to just members' debates. In Ayrshire, where I live, the rates of COPD are among the highest in Scotland. In 2018, NHS Ayrshire and Arran had the highest proportion of people living with COPD in Scotland. This debilitating condition causes ill health at home, but also, as we've heard, long stays in hospital and often repeated readmissions. So in representing the south of Scotland, I have to ask the Scottish Government to take health inequalities seriously. It is incumbent on the Scottish Government to lead a debate on the health inequalities in our country, be held to account on their record and addressing them, and in doing so, we might take some purposeful steps towards helping the tens of thousands of people who are being disproportionately affected by conditions such as COPD as a result of deprivation. We can, and we must do more to help those communities. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Ms Mochan. I now call Rona Mackay, will be followed by Stephen Kerr. Ms Mackay, are in 4 minutes too.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'm pleased to be speaking in this debate and thank my colleague Emma Harper for bringing it to the Chamber. Emma's been a champion of lung health and COPD since being elected and was instrumental in the publication of the Respiratory Care Action Plan as well as starting the Lung Health Cross-Party Group. COPD is an umbrella term used to describe several lung conditions, including emphysema and chronic bronchitis. And World COPD, as we've heard, is tomorrow with the theme of healthy lungs, never more important. The condition affects 140,000 people across Scotland, and an estimated 200,000 people across the country are said to be living with undiagnosed COPD, and that's a lot of people. Exposure to tobacco smoke and other inhaled toxic particles and gases are the main COPD risk factors, and the condition causes the lungs to narrow and harden, making breathing difficult and sometimes impossible without oxygen. It affects middle-aged and older people and does usually get worse over time. However, like all health conditions, the outlook from COPD varies from person to person. The condition can't be cured or reversed, but for many people, treatment can help keep it under control so it doesn't severely limit their daily activities and affect their quality of life too adversely. Treatments for COPD include inhalers, tablets, and for a small number of people, surgery or even a lung transplant. As we've heard, the British Lung Foundation, Asthma UK, published a recent survey, Failing in the Fundamentals. We surveyed over 8,000 people from across the four nations in the UK who have a diagnosis of COPD. One of the questions the survey asked those living with COPD was whether they felt they were receiving the five principles of care. Worryingly, the majority of respondents conveyed that they were not receiving these five fundamentals of care, which are offering smoking cessation, offering pneumococcal and flu vaccine, pulmonary rehabilitation, personalised self-management plan and optimising treatment for comorbidities. That's why I welcome the steps that have been taken by the Scottish Government to improve the outcomes of those living with COPD, including through the publication of the Respiratory Care Action Plan in March of this year, which aims to improve the care and support people with this lung condition. It sets out the government's vision for driving improvement and support of people living with these conditions. Presiding Officer, we know that poverty and poor housing conditions play a large part in the prevalence of COPD, and Carol Mochan articulated that very well. Smoking, damp housing conditions and pollution all add to the likelihood of contracting COPD. Housing, of course, is down to government policies and priorities, and that's why the Scottish Government are implementing an ambitious new plan to provide 110,000 warm, affordable homes by 2032. Of course, to avoid the lungs deteriorating fast and to give them a chance to heal, stopping smoking is a must, as is avoiding polluted areas where possible. And again, our new climate change and carbon emissions targets will help future generations in that regard. Presiding Officer, Scotland's industrial past always features in the causes of COPD. Asbestosis in the shipyards or in construction is another form of lung disease which was rife for workers of my parents' generation. Thankfully, we know much more about health and safety in the workplace now, and those risks have been minimised, but many generations paid a heavy price just to put food on the table for their families. So in conclusion, Presiding Officer, can I thank Emma Harper again for bringing this important debate to the Chamber, and I look forward to progress being made on this vital issue. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms Mackay. I now call Stephen Kerr to be followed by Claire Adams in 4 minutes, Mr Kerr.
Deputy Presiding Officer, it is a privilege to be able to speak in this important debate to mark COPD Awareness Day, which falls tomorrow. And it's a pleasure to follow Rona Mackay, and I give my hearty congratulations to Emma Harper for bringing this debate to the Chamber. COPD is something which is very personal to me because my dad had the condition for many years. We've heard about the 140,000 Scots today that live with that condition. And he did it with the support of his family and those around him. Chronic obstructive pulmonary disease affects everyday life. It leads to shortness of breath, wheezing, tightening of the chest, constant coughing, a feeling of tiredness, and more propensity to succumb to colds and flus. That being said, it is a condition that can be lived with and can be slowed significantly if caught early, and with lifestyle changes. I witnessed that in my dad's case. Dad did everything in his power to control his COPD. He was determined to take control of his condition rather than let the condition take control of him. He took mild exercise daily. He walked a fair few steps, I'll tell you, every day. He took up yoga in his 80s. And that was part of a brilliant, he was part of a brilliant support group in Forfar called Forfar Airways, a peer support group for people living in the Forfar area with COPD. Forfar Airways is supported by Chest, Heart and Stroke Scotland. That support group meant a great deal to my dad. The members of the group became great friends, and they were there for each other in the good times and in the bad. I can't speak too highly of Forfar Airways and other peer support groups like them. COPD is a disease that most commonly affects smokers, but it's by no means limited to smokers. My dad had smoked when he was younger, but had long since given up. COPD can also be the result of prolonged exposure to workplace dusts, chemicals and fumes. Dad may have been a case in point. He was a butcher by trade. These are the facts which bear repeating, but we must be careful. Too often we are censorious of those who have had unhealthy lifestyles, people who drink too much, who have smoked, who are overweight, or who suffer from stigmatised diseases that we think of as being somehow their own fault. When we talk like that, we can sometimes cause guilt, discomfort, or feelings of stupidity in those who suffer from these conditions. I'm reminded of the line, "O Lord, thou kenst what zeal I bear when drinkers drink and swearers swear," as it was the attitude of Holy Willie that we should seek to avoid. That attitude of Holy Willie is the one that we should seek to avoid when it comes to health matters. I say today, Deputy Presiding Officer, stigma is also a killer in this condition and so many others. There is a stigma attached to asking for help, which we must address. We must be careful not to make people feel stupid or guilty, and in putting people off asking for help, because help is on offer. So many people who suffer from COPD do not know what help is available, what support they can get, and how they can manage their own conditions. So I ask the government what they are doing and what more they can do to ensure that people who suffer from COPD are aware of what support they can get. And I would also like to ask the government what we are doing to ensure earlier diagnosis of COPD, as we know that an earlier diagnosis is key to people managing their conditions. I would finally like to know if the government acknowledges the issues that I have raised in my speech about stigma and what steps they are taking to remove it. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr Kerr. I now call Claire Adamson, who joins us remotely, and will be followed by Monica Lennon. Ms Adamson, 4 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Can I congratulate my colleague Emma Harper on securing tonight's debate and commend her for her ongoing commitment to COPD and lung health through her work in the cross-party group in this session and the previous session. And I also thank my colleagues across the Chamber this evening who have raised many of the issues that I feel very strongly about. As a member for a constituency in industrial Lanarkshire, I know all too well some of the issues around our industrial heritage that have been mentioned here already. And also to thank Stephen Kerr for what was a very personal reflection on his own experience with COPD. Slightly differently, I want to give a little sliver of hope for those who may be suffering from COPD, because tonight I want to talk about COPD choirs. I believe the first choir I saw was at a an event hosted by Ms Harper a number of years ago when the Borders Chain Gang performed and also shared their experience with me. As a convener of Constitution Europe External Relations and Culture Committee, I'm very aware of the role culture can and should play in wellbeing, and the government has put that at the heart of its policy making across portfolios, a wellbeing nation. A COPD choir is an incredible way to help and improve the lives of COPD patients. In 2014, Tayside Health Arts Trust did a 9-week programme, including introduced to a choir across the Chris Kelly and I highlight this project because you can see how brilliant it was on YouTube and hear it firsthand, the wonderful experiences of those participating in it. And I would advocate colleagues to look at this and also to look at the Chain Gang, but if they're searching, Chain spelled C-H-E-Y-N-E. The British Lung Foundation itself note that music making and other creative activities can make you feel healthier and more positive. There's increasing evidence that singing regularly as a part of a group is good for your health and well-being. It seems to be especially good at improving your quality of life if you're living with a lung condition. Singing as a group is good for people with no experience of singing, as well as those who have loved music their whole life. In assessing its effectiveness, they asked sufferers to explain what the choir had meant to them. And many people with lung conditions say singing helps them feel less short of breath, more control of their breathing. It helps by teaching you to breathe more slowly and deeply, improving your sense of control over breathing, reducing anxiety and potential feelings of panic, and improving your posture to help you breathe more efficiently. But also, it just helps you feel more positive. People say singing is uplifting and joyful. They feel positive during the singing session and they can have a positive mood continues afterwards, and it helps them feel less depressed, less stressed, less anxious, and Mr. Kerr, I certainly hope, less stigmatised. Whether your choice is Yes, Sir, I Can Boogie or Gaelic walking songs, music permeates our culture. Wellbeing needs the arts, and when COPD choirs can bring community, friendship, fun, enjoyment, resilience and happiness, and at the same time improve health, will Minister ask you what's not to like? And please, can we have them in every health board in Scotland? And a final message, Presiding Officer, in the spirit of another activity, keep singing.
Thank you very much, Ms Adamson. I'm sure Monica Lennon will bear that in mind. Monica Lennon, 4 minutes to be followed by Finlay Carson.
Into song, Presiding Officer. Can I also thank Emma Harper for securing what is a really important debate ahead of World COPD Day, which is tomorrow. And I also declare an interest as a lung champion as well. I know there's many of us in the chamber, and that is a positive. And I want to thank Asthma UK and the British Lung Foundation Scotland and Chest, Heart, Stroke Scotland, not just for the briefings, but for all the work that they do every day of the year. I had a kind of speech written down, but in these debates, you kind of go with the flow when you respond to colleagues. And I have to say, that was a really powerful speech from Stephen Kerr. They do say the personal is political. And I think you've left us with a lot to reflect on there. And I look forward to hearing what the Minister says about that issue you've raised about stigma. My dad also had COPD, and he was a heavy smoker. He was a heavy drinker. And probably you could look at all the sort of lifestyle issues that were going on there. But what I do know is it's a horrible, horrible, well, it can be a horrible, horrible condition that really has a serious impact on quality of life. But we do know that with the correct diagnosis and the correct treatment and self-management, that we can help people to live well as possible. So it was good to hear from Claire Adamson about the Chain Gang Choir. That does sound like a lot of fun. Last week, I also had some young people singing to me at an event during COP26 that Asthma UK and the British Lung Foundation hosted in Oran Mór, outside of the official COP venue. And I won't sing it, but the children sang to me, "Pollution, pollution, it damages our lungs. Save the environment, plant more trees, stop idling and turn engines off." It does sound better when you hear them singing it. I did tweet it at the time. But what also really struck me about that panel event was a wee boy who I think was 12 years old, and he said that from when he started primary school until now, there are more inhalers in the school cupboard. So that's not so much about COPD, but I think it tells us that, yes, in the past we've known about industrial injury, we know about smoking and drinking and things that are badged as lifestyle issues, but in terms of what we need to do around environmental pollution, we can't ignore the science, and I know it's Road Safety Week as well, so perhaps the Minister will take back to her other ministerial colleagues that we do need to be joined up and making sure that we give our children the best start in life so that they don't grow up to develop conditions like COPD. In terms of some of the great work that's going on, I was also pleased to hear Stephen Kerr and others talk about the important role of Chest Heart Stroke Scotland in terms of advocacy and practical support. And I do hope the Minister will join me in recognising the really brilliant model of service that we have in home to hospital. And I wonder what more government can do to support that really important work. In terms of being a lung health champion, my role is pulmonary rehab, so it would be remiss of me not to ask what action is underway to really urgently get pulmonary rehab services restarted and also to be supported with additional investment. As I say, I promise I won't sing, but it does sound like we're all on the same hymn sheet in terms of that the action needs to happen. I agree with Claire Adamson that there is a lot to be hopeful about, but as Carol Mockin has said, this is an issue about poverty and class, it is an issue about health inequality, and we need to know what targeted action will be taken to address that. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Ms Lennon. It falls to Finlay Carson to conclude the open debate. 4 minutes, Mr Carson.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer, and I thank Emma Harper for bringing this debate to the Chamber. COPD is hugely important, and now with the COVID pandemic, this topic is going to be something of a long player because of the real severity of the problem facing us right now today and in the future. Asthma UK and the British Lung Foundation has published the results of the first ever survey undertaken to discover the impacts of COPD. And the study, the largest ever conducted in the UK, reveals the real picture around the levels of fundamental care and highlights what support those suffering from this harrowing lung disease actually receive in dealing with its common debilitating lung condition. And the results make for grim reading. It's estimated that across our country some 140,000 people are currently living with this long-term chronic lung condition. And worryingly, that figure could be far greater. The findings reveal that over 4 in 5 people are missing out on the basics of care as defined by NICE, highlighting that 5 fundamentals of COPD care are simply not being met. And this is unacceptable given that COPD has a massive impact on a person's quality of life and often fatal. The report also highlights that despite the growing numbers diagnosed, COPD is often misunderstood among the wider public, with nearly half of the sufferers believing that people thought badly of them because they had the condition. Sadly, many people are misdiagnosed first time, with some dismissed as merely having a chest infection or cough. And this is largely down to spirometry not available to them at the appropriate time. Also revealed is that over 58% of Scots admitted that their mental health had worsened since their diagnosis, with more than a third having to leave their employment permanently, whilst others stopped any volunteering activities. And it's clear that we cannot carry on like this. These poor levels of COPD diagnosis and care must be urgently addressed with the Scottish Government and health boards. Asthma UK and the British Lung Foundation have outlined a strong case to try and tackle this worrying situation and are rightly repeating their calls for national lung health screening programmes to be undertaken in Scotland. And one of the reasons I'm so passionate about this topic is partly because of this high prevalence in my constituency, particularly in Stranraer and across the southwest corner of Scotland. Right now, why that is, nobody can be quite certain. However, as we've heard, there's a 50-strong team of scientists and researchers led by Professor John Lockhart from the School of Health and Life Sciences at the University of the West of Scotland, and they're working to unlock the mystery of why rural southwest Scotland has become such a hotspot. And Emma touched on the school visits that they carry out. Now he's delighted to attend Kirkinner School with John as part of his work of raising the profile. Professor Lockhart believes it could be genetic or environmental or even agricultural related. But the outbreak of COVID-19 further highlights the danger of this respiratory disease, especially among the vulnerable who have been asked to shield and were rightly prioritised for vaccine and subsequent booster jabs. Alarmingly, the high death rate figure in Stranraer from COVID at nearly four times higher than elsewhere could point to the town's poor health and unexplained lung health, which is why I've been campaigning for several years now. And I called the first meeting with Dumfries and Galloway Health Board and Professor Lockhart way back in 2018. And if I remember correctly, Emma Harper's sister, Dr. Phyllis Murphy, who's a leading light and respiratory conditions, and I know that from personal experience, because with their support, my obstructive sleep apnea, and I will be forever grateful for her assistance. But we looked at the possibility of creating a centre of excellence for lung health in Stranraer. Certainly, if the presiding officer will give us time.
Emma Harper.
I thank Mr. Carson for taking intervention. I'm just wondering if he would like me to pass that message on to my sister.
Finlay Carson.
Absolutely, I very much would, and I'm sure my wife would pass on because I sleep a lot better than I used to do, and she certainly does as well. But I'm pleased that Emma recognised that there is the chance of a centre of excellence, and indeed I've asked the First Minister and successive health ministers to look at the establishment of such a facility. A physical presence in Stranraer would help build on the creation of a dedicated COPD-focused training hub established under the BREATH project, which is to increase research, public awareness and enterprise focused on lung-related life-threatening diseases. Not only would the centre be able to gather important local data from Dumfries and Galloway, but also Ayrshire and Arran, as well as Northern Ireland, where similarly there's high cases, number of cases reported. It's estimated that this centre of excellence would cost in the region of £4 million to set up, which in the wider picture of health funding is a very small price to pay. There could also be a number of commercial possibilities to ensure sustainability, whereby the lab facilities could be used to generate income through local agricultural businesses and the like. And I'm not alone in the desire to see such a centre. And Professor Lockhart has already stated that the creation of a COPD centre of excellence would be a welcome news, stating that such a facility could cater for long needs by realising local potential, including stimulating innovation across the region by facilitating patient care and increasing research, public awareness and enterprise. The BREATH project is already collaborating on research, educating young people and harnessing complementary resources and expertise, as Emma Harper touched on, with a mission to alleviate the impact of what is an incurable disease. Deputy Presiding Officer's wide words, and I sincerely hope it will lead to wise actions in the future.
Thank you very much indeed, Mr. Carson. I now call on Marie Todd to respond to the debate. I'll let her choose whether or not to do it through the medium of song, but Minister, be obliged for around 7 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I definitely won't respond through the medium of song. You'd all be most troubled if I did. But I did love Claire Adamson's contribution to the debate, and she brought a very different view, and it was just delightful to hear, and I hope that these COPD choirs do spread throughout the country. Presiding Officer, I'm delighted to respond to this debate, and I want to thank Emma Harper for lodging the motion. It's really important that we raise awareness of chronic obstructive pulmonary disease, and I want to join the Chamber in acknowledging World COPD Day taking place tomorrow. I'll try to respond. There's many issues being raised during this debate, and I'll try to respond to all of them, but I'm more than happy to discuss them with members after the debate if I should run short of time in responding to the issues raised. This year's theme, Healthy Lungs, Never More Important, highlights the impact that COVID-19 has had on the nation's lung health and the challenges faced by those living with respiratory conditions like COPD during the pandemic have been incredibly difficult to deal with. Over 80,000 people in Scotland with a respiratory condition were asked to shield, the largest group of people within the shielding list. Now, COVID-19 has undoubtedly impacted access to treatment and care, with some people facing stark choices: travel to hospital sites for treatment, or stay home and miss out on potentially crucial interventions. And in addition, we know that shielding can have significant impacts on physical and mental health. The impact of COVID-19 on delivery of care and treatment for people with COPD continues to be significant, but respiratory services have continued throughout the pandemic. For urgent suspected cancer clinics and outpatient services for urgent respiratory concerns within the hospital and community respiratory teams playing a key role in the COVID-19 response. And third sector organisations, as highlighted by several members, have also continued to provide invaluable support through this difficult time. To those living with respiratory conditions like the Chest, Heart and Stroke Scotland's Hospital to Home Service, which I would also commend. In Scotland, with regard to tackling the fundamentals in Scotland, we do this through our priorities and commitments set out in our first Respiratory Care Action Plan for Scotland, published in March this year, and my thanks go to everyone who offered invaluable contributions in development of the plan. The plan sets out key priority areas for prevention, for diagnosis, for treatment and for care for people living with respiratory conditions in Scotland. And I want to thank Asthma UK and the British Lung Foundation and Chest, Heart and Stroke Scotland, the Alliance and others for the important work that they do to support people with respiratory conditions and their families and friends. We're particularly grateful for their work with us to ensure that people with lived experience of respiratory conditions are closely involved as we make progress against the commitments that are set out in the Respiratory Care Action Plan. A key part of this plan is ensuring early and accurate diagnosis of COPD, and we know that this can enable treatment and support to begin before the disease has progressed. When people are given information about their condition early, they have much more opportunity to explore self-management techniques and to avoid possibly intensive treatments. And upon diagnosis, people should then enter an appropriate treatment pathway which is supported by safe and effective prescribing. Of course, the management, the diagnosis has been disrupted by the COVID pandemic. Spirometry is an aerosol-generating procedure. There isn't a single area of this pathway that hasn't been impacted. And we face significant challenges to provide appropriate treatment and care as we recover from the pandemic. And of course, as we're all aware, we are not quite through and out of it. So there's likely to be pent-up demand, and there is still complexities involved in infection control. We're also aware that there's likely to be a rate of deconditioning within the respiratory community, and the preventative programmes such as pulmonary rehab have been impacted, and third sector and virtual programmes will play a vital role in preventing that deconditioning and stabilising it. So coming on to pulmonary rehabilitation, the respiratory care pathway offers a structured exercise and education programme designed for people living with a respiratory condition. Throughout the programme, participants are offered advice about specific medications and how to use them, information on diet, weight management, mental health support. Pulmonary rehab is one of the most effective forms of management for people living with respiratory conditions, and in particular COPD. 90% of people completing the programme experience improved exercise capacity or increased quality of life. Our priority on the issue of availability is ensuring that people get the right care at the right time, as close to home as possible. We know that most cases of COPD are caused by inhaling pollutants, fumes, chemicals and dust found in many work environments are contributing factors for many individuals who develop COPD. Genetics may also play a role in an individual's susceptibility, even if the person has never smoked or been exposed to strong lung irritants in the workplace. to reduce exposure to known risk factors like tobacco and air pollution and respiratory infections, we have to collaborate across multiple sectors. Now, as others have said, the majority of COPD cases, 90% of them, are caused by the toxins in tobacco smoke. It would be remiss of me not to highlight that in my summing up. From the moment tobacco smoke enters the mouth, it damages tissue and cells on the way to the lungs, and as a result, smoking causes lung diseases, including the majority of COPD cases. It makes chronic lung diseases more severe, and it increases the risk of respiratory infections. Every year, tobacco use is associated with 108,000 smoking attributable hospital admissions and 9,332 smoking attributable deaths every year, a fifth of all deaths. So this year's programme for government committed to a refreshed tobacco action plan built on the pillars of prevention, protection and cessation to achieve our target of lowering Scotland's smoking rate to 5% or lower by 2034, putting tobacco out of sight and out of mind for future generations. My colleague Carol Mochen is absolutely right to raise the issue of health inequality in this context. I share her passion to tackle this, and indeed I believe that tackling health inequalities needs to be a golden thread through all that we do. Stephen Kerr spoke very powerfully about the issue of stigma. Now, as ever, of course, stigma can deter people from beginning to smoke, from taking up smoking, and that can be a helpful thing. But you're right, it can make it more difficult for smokers to stop. So there needs to be balance with this, as in all issues. And Monica Lennon also touched on the issue of generational, the fact that it's a generational issue. Now, I am running short of time, as I predicted I would, so I won't mention about flu vaccinations. We've heard plenty about the flu vaccine programme in the Chamber today, but it's the biggest ever that Scotland has carried out. Really vitally important that people with lung conditions get their flu vaccine, and we are well on the way to making sure that that happens. I want to thank again Emma Harper for lodging the motion for this important debate and for providing an opportunity for us to talk about the challenges faced by those living with COPD. Thank you.
Thank you very much indeed, Minister. That concludes the debate, and I close this meeting of Parliament.